Welcome to the What's Happening Birmingham video podcast.
This podcast is brought to you by the Vintage Shops.
Hi, this is Natalie Ball. Check us out here at the Vintage Shops in Hoover. We have consignment and antique mall with vendors and new furniture. We are located in Hoover beside Big Lots and Bed Bath & Beyond. Or you can call us at area code 205-968-1700.
Hello everyone, this is Jarvis Escott with What's Happening Birmingham. Today I have the honor and pleasure of being with Mr. Jeremy Duckworth. He is the Executive Director of the Western Communities Redevelopment Alliance. Jeremy, good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you for coming on the podcast today.
Thank you for having me.
Great, great. I want to bring Jeremy on to talk about this wonderful organization that he has started on the western side of Jefferson County, or I'd say Jefferson County wide, pretty much. So, Jeremy, tell me about the Western Communities Redevelopment Alliance, your story, how you came up with this great organization.
Well, cool. Well, I can't take the credit for this organization all by myself. We have a great active board and also some great, amazing partners in the corporate community as well. And I just want to say thank you to my board of directors for all the help they've given us. But part of this story is also a shared story. And so thank you, Jarvis, for having us on today. This is amazing. I've seen a lot of your interviews and you do such a great job. And so thank you for what you do in the community. My story is one that I think is not very unique, and it's not also very excitable, but it's my true story. And so I'm from a small town called Taylorsville, Mississippi. Grew up there from 0 to 5. My dad worked for a company called Amoco, and we moved to Tuscaloosa, Alabama. My mom was a school teacher. Had a very privileged life all of my life. Great childhood, and enjoyed growing up in Tuscaloosa. Moved to Birmingham area, metro area, about 13 years ago. I was 23 years old, moved here. And I moved here because I had a small business. It was a golf green company that I was partnered with. And so enjoyed doing that. Worked for a local company, local credit union in town. And then I started working for a medical distribution company as well. Did that for about 10 years. And so 5 years ago, and this is just my story, and I know it might rub some people like, well, no, don't talk about this or don't talk about that, but this is truly my story. 5 years ago, a gentleman named Walter Scott in South Carolina was running from the police, and he got shot in the back. And it was just disheartening for me. And I thought to myself, man, what can we do? What can I do to make a difference in the community of people that look like myself, right? Or in underserved communities. And so I was praying to God, and it felt like the next week, but honestly, it was 2 months later, Freddie Gray died in the back of a police van in Baltimore. And that's when they had all those riots in Baltimore and things of that nature. And so I was just praying to God, asking God, what can I do? I've had this amazing life. I got a great wife. I got great kids. I have great family, great friends, but what can I do to make a true difference in the community that looks like myself? And so I sat down with a couple people, businessmen in the area, in Birmingham metro area, talked to them about my desire to do something in the community, to bring my skill set to the community. And they said, you know what, we welcome what you're talking about doing, and we want to build a platform, help you build a platform for that. And so that's how we got started. Built the Chamber of Commerce called the Fairfield Business Alliance 5 years ago in Fairfield. Did a lot of great things with recruiting businesses here, extra space storage, Magic City Dance Studio, Gary Law Firm, Thomas Family Medicine. Did a lot of great things in Fairfield. Did a workforce development program here as well. But I still didn't see the systemic change that I wanted to see in the community, right? And so we had some more conversations with leaders in the SBA. And through those conversations, we realized that we can have more of a regional impact if we affected just not only Fairfield, but Fairfield, Midfield, West Birmingham, Brighton, Lipscomb, and Bessemer if they need any help as well. And so we then formed the Western Communities Redevelopment Alliance. And so 3 kids, 9, 6, and 4, married to an awesome woman of God, Jennifer Elizabeth Duckworth, who's an entrepreneur in her own right, a mompreneur, I call her. Okay. And so that's my story, man.
All All right, so with the organization, what type of services and programs do you provide?
Well, it's people, I think, a lot of times get the wrong idea of what we do. They kind of confuse us with a chamber of commerce.
Okay.
Yeah. A lot of times, right? Yeah. They think we're going to be a chamber, and we're really not. What we focus on is we are an economic development organization.
Okay.
And what we focus on is increasing capacity on a small municipality level, where we would partner with chambers, existing chambers in the area. We'll also come in and build a business alliance alongside of that small municipality. We'll also focus on small business development capacity, where we utilize two initiatives. One is the Western Small Business Accelerator, and two is our technical assistance for small businesses that want to come into the area of this great Western area who want to expand as well. And our third program is one where we kind of focus more on people. And that's the workforce development component of it. And I'll be remiss in saying that a lot of people have not played a huge role in helping us develop these programs. So thank you and kudos to every of our volunteers, all of our partners out there. I'm eternally grateful for you guys just being obedient to God. And so our third component, again, is workforce development, where we do a program called Alabama College and Career Access Program.
Okay.
And we give out about $10 million in scholarships every year through this opportunity, through this program.
Okay, well, let's go back to that accelerator for a minute. I just want you to tell me more about that.
Yeah, sure. The accelerator was something we've been thinking about, you know, since we started, you know, FBA and WCRA.
Okay.
We've been having conversations with business owners about what can be really tangible for a small business owner to move their business forward, not for a startup, right? Because we don't really want to work with the startups at this point because we just don't have the capacity for it. But what about a business that's already in the air, flying right now? They have a lot of their components in place, but they don't have the full capacity to expand and grow. And so we've been having this conversation for a long time, but what we realized is that we got to tap into our local universities, right? Because a lot of times they have the proven best practices already, but they don't get a chance to teach them to the small business owner. And a lot of times, like you, like myself, like many other small businesses, we honestly got into it just to help somebody, right? To provide a service. And all of a sudden we called it a business. So now that we're in business now on what I would call almost an accident, right? Mm-hmm. Now what do I do? I'm mm-hmm. making money, I'm doing these things, but what do I do now? And so we take three simple approaches. One is the educational and instructional classes that we provide. Mm-hmm. The second component is that what we call the practical component, mm-hmm. where we actually have students, grad students and professors working alongside these small businesses where they have their actual mini accounting firm or even a mini marketing firm with them. Not only do they get the educational component, but the actual practical component where you can walk alongside these businesses and actually show them how to do something the right way in the right frame of mind and maximize the results doing it. And so our third component of the accelerator is what we call affectionately called expansion, strategic expansion, where a business now has seen growth in their business from the accelerator, but now they're ready to grow and put their business another place and employ more people in the local community, which creates more jobs. Our best example of this so far is a gentleman named Corey Bishop, who owns Refresh Clothing. And yes, Corey's a superstar. Yes, he's an amazing guy, but it really shows you that all he needed was just some more gasoline in his tank to go where he needed to go in his directions.
Okay, because, you know, that's one of the biggest challenges. You can be very successful, like to call them a solo entrepreneur, but to take it and multiply, you know, to be more than yourself. I even see that sometimes I kind of struggle with, you know, back before being in business, mm-hmm. you know, how you take from being that one person multiplying to five.
Correct.
To 10. And that's something where, you know, a lot of people think, well, it's simple, you know, no. revenue, but no, it's because you have to learn, you go from, you can manage yourself, but now you have to manage people, and I'd like to throw another, you know, motivate people, you know,
right.
to do things. So I think that's a great service that you offer, because I know a lot of businesses that are having that, you know, challenge how to get to that next level.
Right.
You know, with that.
A lot of times, and you've seen this with COVID, a lot of times our small businesses in our areas, in our communities, they don't have their bookkeeping and I'm trying to find the right word here, but exactly in the right frame, yeah. right? It's just a few things missing there. Mm-hmm. Or a lot of times they show themselves as being paper poor. Mm-hmm. But you know you can count on this business to underwrite a lot of your, you know, sports programs, social services, mm-hmm. things of that nature. But they're paper poor because they don't want to show the government they're making money. They don't understand, though, is that when you want to expand, right, you're going to need dollars mm-hmm. from outside sources, right? Mm-hmm. And so now they can't get a loan from the bank. Mm-hmm. Now they can't get a equity investment from a private investor. Now they can't deal with a micro lender. And so one of the biggest missing components that I've seen so far in being economic development for small business retention and growth is accounting. And what does that look like? Actually having those internal processes and controls in place to capture the dollars that are coming into your business and making sure you maximize them as well. And then actually doing a market analysis for where you are in business, right? A lot of times when people get in business, they say, well, I just want to be here. And you would ask them why. Mm-hmm. What do they say? What do they usually say, Jarvis?
Well, yeah.
They say, oh, I just want to be here because I just want to be here. No, you got to put your business there because it makes sense, which makes dollars, right? You got to make sure that your customer segments are there. The demographics are there as well. And so having somebody on a practical side walk them through this path is priceless.
So it goes beyond just the standard business plan. Now, I know a lot of times people write a business plan and it's just a piece of paper, but what you take with the business plan after it's done and executed.
Yeah, I mean, it's not that. We're not talking about, that's more so an incubator where they teach business plans and things of that nature. Mm-hmm. And that is so needed in the startup mm-hmm. community. Mm-hmm. But what I feel like is the hugest gap right now is actually accelerating businesses that are well established, mm-hmm. that have been around for a couple of years, that have a great accounts receivable, but now they need that push. Mm-hmm. That's what I see is the biggest gap.
Okay. Let's move on to COVID-19. You know, this has been affecting all businesses
yeah.
all over the place.
It has.
How have your organization assisted businesses during this time with COVID-19?
You know, the main thing that we've done is we've also put out videos in place to give education on PPP loans, EIDL loans, updates on what's going on in the community as far as, hey, this is how you get your PPP loan, things that you need to avoid. A great partner of ours is Devrim Veasley, and he came up with the loan application process sheet where it kind of tells you these are things you need to have in order, these are things you don't need to have, and if you don't have these things in order, just get them in order pretty soon and it'll help you. And so we've partnered with a program called Lyft Alabama. It's a subsidiary organization of University of Alabama where a great part of ours, Lisa McKinney, has come alongside of us and said, hey, we'll help small businesses get their accounting things in order, get their accounting, I shouldn't say things, but accounting processes, procedures in order so they can apply for the PPP loan. And those that have participated in the program have received their PPP loan. And so that's what we're doing.
Okay. And the thing, too, I'll tell people about the PPP loan as well is that, like I said, you gotta have your paperwork in order because I love that term you said, paper poor, because a lot of times we've been paying each other, come on, small business, cash out, PayPal, Square, you know, especially people in the service industry, mm-hmm. whether you're a barber, a hairstylist, 90% of y'all take cash.
Right.
If you don't take cash, you'll take PayPal and all those type places. And while that's good, but it's not showing a salary or it's not showing you paying any taxes to Uncle Sam.
Correct.
And businesses that benefited during this time were the ones that had employees. And even if you was a solo person, if you showed you paid yourself, you could have missed out. And this money would have been forgivable.
Correct. You're exactly right. But I think that also comes from a standpoint of not having the knowledge about it. Right. And if you don't have the knowledge about, well, I should pay myself a salary. And if you also don't have the knowledge of why you should do it, how it's advantageous for you, then you're not going to do it. So many times when COVID, especially in April and May, I heard so many small business owners say, oh, that money's not for me. Oh, I can't. That's for those guys over there. And they can't admit that they're just intimidated about something they don't know. Because throughout their history, when they don't know something, somebody has always tried to put them at a disadvantage, right? And so what we want to do through this whole COVID process and pandemic is say, you know what? Here's a safe place that you can be vulnerable about your business, and we will honestly just help you. Come alongside of us. We'll hold your hand. And I give this example a lot of times, and it's a good example, but I like it a whole lot. But with my kids, right? My kids are small. I think you just kind of ran into them earlier. And 9, 6, and 4, I don't just tell my 6 and 4 year old how to cross the street, right? I hold their hands multiple amount of times, and I'm saying, hey, this is how you cross the street. You always got to stop and look. And I do this, drivers, until they get it. You get what I'm saying? I don't stop and say, well, do you get it now? I hold their hand until they actually can do it on their own. And then I watch them to observe, can they do it on their own? And once they can, then I feel safe. And I feel like as an economic development organization, our primary role is to make sure that we increase economic development capacity and make sure that our existing businesses not only feel like they can expand and make more money, but that they feel safe. And how they feel safe is through knowledge and operations.
Okay, so for more information, I'd like to contact you. What's your phone number?
So to reach out to me, you can email us at info@jeffcowcra.org. That's info@jeffcowcra.org. And my phone number is 205-561-8373. And man, thank you for this interview. It's been amazing.
Well, thank you too, Jeremy. And I'm gonna have to bring you back. Got another idea session real soon. Bring you in on because you know we've been kind of feel like we're doing like a mini brainstorm session and everything. But yeah, thank you for coming on today. You all please check out this organization, Special Businesses, that's looking to get to that next step. I know some of y'all probably watching, probably wondering, because right now, this is a very crucial time in business, because it's almost like, I tell people, it's almost like survival mode. You know, you got to do whatever it takes that you probably wouldn't do in another time. So, thank you all for watching this video. Please check out whatshappeningbirmingham.com for more videos. And don't forget to subscribe to my YouTube channel. Thank you all again, and have a great day. Bye-bye.
Thank you for watching the What's Happening Birmingham video podcast. Please check out our website, app, or subscribe to our YouTube channel for the latest videos today.